Request all delegates to put off your mics, mute your mics as we begin today's event.
A very blissful good evening to one and all. I am Ms. Rashmi Sawant, Deputy Chief of Nursing, Global Hospital, Mumbai, would like to announce that today we all have gathered together for National Virtual Liver Nursing Conference on the theme of Basic and Advanced Liver Intensive Care, Newer Opportunities for Nursing, in collaboration with Maharashtra Chapter Association of Nurse Executive India. As rightly said by Mr. Henry Ford, coming together is a beginning, keeping together is a progress, working together is a success. Before starting today's meeting, I would like to request all the participants to kindly keep your mics on mute to have an uninterrupted learning session. In course of webinar, if you have any questions, please type in chat box. So let us enlighten today's session with lighting of lamp.
Bham kurutvam kalyanam arogyam dhana sampadah shubham kurutvam kalyanam arogyam dhana sampadah shatru buddhi vinashaya Deepajyotirnamostute Deepajyotirnamostute Shubham Kurutvam Kalyanam Arogyam Dhanasampadah Shubham Kurutvam Kalyanam Arogyam Dhanasampadah
A very warm welcome to one and all. Today we have gathered together for today's conference. We have among us Dr. Vivek Talavlikar, CEO, CDKD Global Hospital, Mumbai, who is the backbone of our organization, a strong motivator as chief guest. I take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Jyoti Glera, J. Michael, Director of Nursing, IHH Healthcare, India Operation Divisions, and National Vice President Annie, who is our mentor, our guide. As well as I welcome Madam Tangam, who is Annie founder, and Madam Shubhada and Madam Ajita. I also welcome very talented person, Chief Nursing Officer, Jupiter Hospital, Mumbai, Ms. Vinci Tribhuvan, who is also President of Maharashtra Chapter NE. We are honored to have Dr. Samir Shah, Head of Department Hepatology, Institute of Liver Diseases, HPV Surgery, and Liver Transplant Surgery. We welcome Dr. Shubhangi Jadhav, Nursing Superintendent, MGM Hospital, Parel, and Vice President, Maharashtra Chapter NE. We welcome our all ANI members on today's occasion. A very warm welcome to all our panelists, our moderators and speakers. Further, we welcome our all beloved nurses who are part of today's event. Once again, welcome you all. Now I invite Dr. Jyoti Glera Michael, Director of Nursing, IHH Healthcare IOD, National Vice President Annie, to kindly address today's forum. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Rashmi. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Pleasant evening wishes to ladies and gentlemen, Annians and non-Annians, those who are participating in today's program. Respected Chief Guest, Dr. Vivek Talavlikar, CEO, Global Hospitals, Mumbai, Tankam Gomez, President ANI, EC members of ANI, ANI National and Chapter officials, those who are present here, Queens of the Day, Maharashtra State Annie President, Vinci, Vice President Dr. Shubhangi, Secretary Jessica, who had thoughtfully put together this conference, who made this conference very colorful and resourceful. And eminent speakers, consultants, nursing heads, principals from various organizations, invited guests and beloved nurses, the evergreen heroes of healthcare. We are very happy to have you all today, and I deem it an honor as a National Vice President of Annie to propose this opening talk. Nursing is legally defined internationally as diagnosis and treatment of human responses, both actual and potential. Over the years in India, if you see, nursing has grown in leaps and bounds with specialization, super specialization, and expanded and extended its role enormously. Newer titles have emerged, and in the recent past, nurse practitioner program launched by INC have paved way for residential programs in nursing, allowing nursing students to spend 50% of their time in the clinical field. Liver Nurse Practitioner is one such program which is in the pipeline, which calls our attention today. This is because of Corona, there was a delay, but soon this program probably will come into play very soon. Not to forget the basics while still advancing the practice is critical in healthcare and most importantly in nursing. Liver nursing is a specialization covering wide spectrum of care, from preventive to curative to rehabilitative. The precision with which nurses have to deliver care is very high for such patients, which includes monitoring, predicting, proactively detecting deviations in patients' responses to treatment that might alter the biophysiological parameters, resulting in preventable complications. The care is highly blended with cutting-edge technology and innovative. Now, out of the PubMed, if you go by literature, in the past 5 years, from 2013 and 17 onwards, in nursing, in chronic diseases, which reveals that liver disease is the least with 10 as compared to COPDs with 249, dementia 734, diabetes 907, and CVDs 1315 cases that is presented and material that is available for references. This urges the need for building body of knowledge in basic and advanced, innovative and contemporary care of concept related to liver disease. So today's conference will give you a thoughtful articulation, well-designed, and it is like a learner-centric program to conceptualize this particular day's experience of yours. The theme today and the sub-theme emerges in the form of a panel. So you will be having several panels today. The essence of the conference is to get yourself oriented, refresh your care concepts, competencies, appreciate preventive, promotive aspects of care, comprehend planning and implementation of liver care quality assurance program, get inspired to become a liver specialist nurse with expanded and extended roles of choice. Learning from conferences normally is short-lived. And this particular conference will give you some take-home messages. Please assimilate, imbibe, and translate all that you have learned in action to benefit the community. We as care providers are accountable also for preventive care. The last year's actually conference which we had, and we planned it to have it in all states, but it is very fortunate that we were able to partake and hand in hand go with Annie and take this conference forward. Thanks to Annie and thanks to Global Hospitals Parel Mumbai team for taking all the effort and making this conference a great success. long awaiting for organ, painful liver workup, uncertainty in progress, financial impact, disturbances in the family dynamic, self-care deficit, and altered quality of life demands the kind of nursing that makes a difference in lives. And that is what you all nurses provide to the patient. I salute the nurses, the liver nurse specialists, the nurse liver coordinators, liver nurse educators, liver nurse managers from all the hospitals across India. You are the unsung heroes who are available with a lamp lit and eyes. I will repeat, lamp lit and eyes all through the night and day with no expectation in return to all what you do and what you mean for the patient and the organization. Hats off to each and every one of you. I'm sure this conference will unfold many thoughts for you, and I wish every single person who is coming forward to share their knowledge as a panelist, as a resource person, as consultants with experience from surgical hepatology perspective and from intensive perspective. I think this will help you to unfold many, many concepts for you to take home back and present yourself as the best nurse in your organization. I thank all the organization heads of the department and also the CEOs and the unit heads for having sponsored you for this particular conference. Wish you all the best, and I'm very delighted for the day. Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am, for your constant support, guidance, and motivational words. Now I invite Ms. Vinci Tribhuvan, CNO Jupiter Hospital, Thane, Mumbai, President of Maharashtra Chapter, ANI, to deliver presidential address. Over to you, ma'am.
Hello, everyone. There are warm greetings to all present here. So as President of Maharashtra, I'm more than happy to be part of this very fruitful event and association between ANI and Global Hospital. Today's event of basic and advanced nursing, intensive liver nursing care. So Global Hospital is one of the eminent institutions recognized and the excellence status they have achieved in liver care and liver transplant services. And Association of Executives of India is no less. They are envisaging a stronger nursing professional, propagating right education and nursing practices. So I guess Global and ANI are deadly combination. So coming to liver diseases, they account approximately, and they are the cause of 2 million deaths across the world. And in India, the burden is more. 22 people of 1 lakh, every 1 lakh population dies from liver diseases and its complication. And it is one of the 10th most commonest cause of death in India. So what are these statistics say? They tell us the importance of creating awareness, not only among nurses, but also other healthcare workers and among public domain. So in the current scenario, nurses are gone. Nurses are only a bedside carer. Now they are an integral part of the expert team who are dealing in human organ care, expanding their horizons to procuring, harvesting, motivating, counseling, and coordinating the entire service, the perioperative care of transplant services. So incorporation of nurses, both at the primary and the hospital care, is one of the very vital aspects if we have to combat against the epidemic of liver diseases and its complication. So how it is possible? You have to, as nurse leaders, as health professionals, we have to continuously create that awareness among nurses, and our education system development has to be towards those importance of combating that disease. And I think Global Hospital is doing a wonderful job on that. I think today's event is an apt one to reach out for our ANI members, as many as nurses possible, to create this awareness. I thank you very much, my ANI office bearers, Tangam Gomez, Dr. Jyoti Clara, Shubda Sakurikar, Ajita ma'am, and of course, Dr. Jyoti Clara and Team Global for giving me this opportunity. Looking forward to an enriching session and also hoping for many more collaboration between both ANI and Global for future events. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable message. Next, I invite Dr. Shubhangi Jadhav, Nursing Superintendent, MGM Hospital, Parel, Vice President, Maharashtra Chapter, ANI, to speak few words to the gathering. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you so much. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. Liver is the heaviest organ, which is performing more than 500 functions in the body. It works as a industry. It is working as an industrial hub, storehouse, and processing plant, working 24/7. It can maintain its normal functioning with only 30% of its cells functioning. Globally, around 25,000 liver transplants are performed per year. And in US, around 8,000 liver transplants are being performed. In India, definitely for the liver failure, the mortality is slightly higher, but definitely the survival, the success rates of liver transplants are quite good. So it is actually really amazing that Global Hospital had organized a virtual liver conference in association with ANI. I would like to congratulate Madam Jessica for such an amazing initiative, really amazing by you and your team. Madam Jessica, being a secretary for Maharashtra Chapter ANI, and definitely we will keep going with such kind of activities and keep shining as Maharashtra Chapter ANI. I would like to extend all the best wishes for all the conference speakers, for today's speakers. We healthcare workers are all fascinated to talk and discuss about the treatment aspects and the advancement of the in the health in the field of health sciences, but we are really rarely talk about the preventive strategies. Really, it is very sad, but it is true. As a nursing professionals, being vital part of healthcare delivery system, need to regularly update ourselves to render the evidence-based nursing services. We need to focus more on the nursing assessment aspects so that our healthcare clients will benefit out of it. And definitely we need to keep our clients educated. Don't miss a single opportunity. Don't miss a single chance to educate our patients as well as their family and the community. I need to specially mention that I really feel privileged to get associated with a national level platform as a Vice President, Maharashtra Chapter ANI, where there is a culture of sharing, caring, and exchange of information to strengthen the nursing professionals and nursing community. With this, I would like to wish all the success for this conference. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you, ma'am, for the motivational words. Further, I request our chief case for the day, Dr. Vivek Talavlikar, CEO CDKD Global Hospital, Mumbai, to share his message to students.
Thank you. A very good afternoon to all my nursing colleagues, panelists who have joined us today for the National Conference on Liver Nursing Care. First of all, I would like to tell you that Global Hospital Mumbai has been in the forefront in transplant, and we are the busiest multi-organ transplant center in Western India. We are very active, not only in liver, pancreas, kidney, but also heart, lung, and we have done a bilateral hand transplant during the pandemic. Our hospital has been active during the entire 2020 period not only handling COVID patients, but also having a very separate and demarcated zone for transplant patients. We at a time during the pandemic, we were faced with a dilemma whether we should be treating transplant patients, but we realized that we could never say no to our patients who have been following up with us and our team members and our doctors for years together. So when the time came during the pandemic, we went all ahead. And as a matter of fact, our team has been successful in doing 80 multi-organ transplants during the year 2020, especially during the 9 months of the pandemic. So this has been a big achievement for us. And it was possible only because of the backbone of nursing care, which was available. As we went ahead with the pandemic and rolled out the transplant program, we could see that patients from far and wide were traveling all the way just to Mumbai hospital, to our hospital, just for the transplants. And we were happy to take care of them in a completely different environment in the hospital. We had hospitals within the hospital, and this was a very, very bright spot during the pandemic period. What I can also say is that the very fact that our team was initiated to hold this national conference for nursing, and that also on the topic of liver nursing care, is a matter of pride for us. Liver nursing care has been a very, very special department for us, because we have always realized that we have always been not only the leaders, but our responsibility is also to pass on our knowledge and our experiences to everybody across. We have got one of the strongest team of hepatologists and liver transplant surgeons at our hospital in Mumbai. But nothing was possible if the strong nursing care was not there. When I meet my nursing team in the liver department, I realize that they are almost as equal to the doctors. They are not only there with the patient right from the start, at the beginning, when the patient has just come into the OPD for an evaluation or even an assessment, but also towards the end, till the end, the patient gets discharged and may or may not come for follow-ups or for further treatments if at all required. The biggest role the nursing team plays is the time and attention that they pay to our patients. And I think that's been a big reason for our success at Global Hospital Mumbai. The nursing team, I have always seen, spends the maximum time from the OPD right to the inpatient and the ICU areas. And especially the kind of care that they have been providing for our pediatric liver transplant patients has been actually gratifying. I can tell you, I get personally involved with the pediatric patients, especially because of the kind of attachment that I have developed to the program, that I see that almost every patient they know completely personally. They know their family members, they know their treating, supporting family members and colleagues, and it helps that there is complete continuity throughout the care of the patient in the hospital. There has been a time when our liver has one of the brightest spots of our hospital, and I'm glad that the nursing team has selected this as the first topic for our national conference. I'm sure that today's fruitful discussions would help not only the nursing across all our other units, but also across the country who have joined to participate in this conference. I would also like to congratulate and thank Madam Thankam, Madam Dr. Jyoti Clara, and the ANEI chapter of Maharashtra, who have supported us in this conference. I wish all the best and wish you all the nursing team members a very fruitful discussions today. Have a nice day and look forward to holding such conferences again and again. And we are always there to support from our side. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for spending your valuable time with us. Your presence always spreads positive energy to the people around you. Next, I invite our Chief Nursing Officer, Ms. Jessica D'Souza, to give us a brief about scope of liver care and transplant nurse. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Rashmi. It is my pleasure over here to be with a group of nurses who have been an excellent support in caring for our liver patients, pre-transplant, post-transplant, and with various types of liver failures, not only adults, but also small children. And we were the first one to have the smallest lightweight baby in the western part of India doing a transplant. It feels me proud that as medical field is been growing to greater heights with advancement of technology, with newer diseases coming in, with newer healthcare facilities being stepping in, we as nurses have never kept ourselves back. We have moved forward along with our entire team to be in par with the healthcare facilities required. As we all know, liver care was not one of the leading topic few years ago, but as advancement of technology has happened, today all our nurses are well trained in taking all type of care for critical patients, especially patients who are coming with ALF. It is the extreme skilled nurses' hands that, with the support of the doctors, guidance of the doctors, could help the patient come out from a liver failure and successfully go back home. Credit to all the nurses who are taking this passion out in learning, taking interest in learning newer technologies. For example, handling of PICO monitoring, handling of CRRT equipments, which was not available a few years ago. As advancement of technology has come in, they have taken keen interest to learn these equipments, to handle it, to face challenges, to overcome hurdles and successfully handle the patients. They have done, handling a CRRT machine, if there are challenges coming in for a nurse, they are so competent enough calling up the companies, making video calls to handle, and they successfully come out in providing the best possible care to the patients. They know the infection control bundles at the tip of their tongue so that they provide that possible care to prevent a patient going into sepsis. Credit to every nurse who has taken this step forward and kept ourselves that nursing is no less than any other healthcare profession, and nurses has a greater role to move forward in the decades to come. All the best to every nurse. Global Hospital is always open for any queries from various organizations for nurses who have doubts in taking care of high-end care patients. We are there to support you all, to reach you all out for any queries. Thank you, everyone. And I request all of you all to wait till the end of the session. We have interesting panels coming, hands-on done by the nurses who have provided care for the patients. They would be presenting their case presentations out of their knowledge and their experience. It's one of its kind where the nurse themselves are presenting their case presentations. So look back to wait for you all to enjoy till the end of the program. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for refreshing our knowledge on scope of liver care and transplant nurses. Moving on to today's program, we would like to display a video which is shared by Dr. Samisha, HOD Hepatology, Institute of Liver Diseases, HPB Surgery and Liver Transplant Surgery, Global Hospital, Mumbai.
I'm happy that the nursing department at the Global Hospital and
video, please, Vinita.
I'm happy that the nursing department at the Global Hospital and the Maharashtra chapter of the ANEI have decided to have liver as a topic for today's webinar, and specifically liver intensive care as the topic for discussion. We are very happy that we have been able to set up a liver intensive care here at the Global Hospital in Mumbai. So there have been cardiac intensive cares, there have been neuro intensive cares, trauma, but liver as an intensive care unit has not been there so far, and we have been happy to establish this year so that we can help out all the liver patients who develop acute liver failure to be properly managed. And there are specific challenges for these patients who have liver failure, specifically nursing challenges, because these patients would have altered sensorium, they may be in coma, they may have bleeding, they would be intubated and ventilated, they would be requiring specific renal replacement therapy called CRRT, plasmapheresis, and basically liver failure involves multiple organs, and multiple organs would need to be supported, and nursing becomes challenging because of this. So that's why we chose today's topic as liver intensive care, and for this we have selected three cases which will sort of highlight many of the issues which nurses face in dealing with these patients with liver failure. We have as faculties hepatologists, liver surgeons and intensivists of the Global Hospital in Mumbai. We are also fortunate that the nursing perspective is looked after by the cases being presented by nurses and moderated by senior faculty of the nursing fraternity. So I hope you enjoy these cases and not only this webinar, but also I would love to have this webinar inspire all of you, especially young nurses, to join the liver intensive care for a special fellowship which we are developing for all of you nurses. And we would love to train up nurses for liver intensive care. Wish all of you all the best and a happy webinar today. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for enlightening words. We now will move on to our first case presentation. I cordially invite our panel one expertise, our speaker and moderator, Ms. Sini Siju, to take over the session. Ms. Sini Siju is a nursing superintendent in Bombay Hospital. She has total 18 years of experience in nursing fraternity. She is MSc in nursing. She has completed her MPhil. She is presently pursuing her PhD from TIS Mumbai. She has presented her paper on impact of internal and external labor market on employee and employer selection behavior and migration. She has broadened her scopes in quality nursing care and excellent patient care outcomes with her efforts towards achieving NABH, nursing excellence and AHPI accreditations. Over to you, Ms. Sini.
Very good afternoon to one and all who have joined in here today for the National Nursing Liver Conference. Thank you, Ms. Rashmi, for the lovely introduction. I welcome you all to our first panel discussion and case presentation. Today, I have with me our presenter, Ms. Kavita Shinde, who is a nursing supervisor in the liver and transplant ICU since last 9 years in Global Hospital. She has 15 years of experience in nursing field, and today her session and case study will surely add on to our knowledge on acute liver failure. Today, I also have a panelist for today, that is Dr. Prashanta Rao, a consultant in HPB and transplant surgeon, a lead disease donor liver transplant program. Welcome, sir. We had Dr. Priyesh Patel, who unfortunately is not able to join us today due to the medical emergency, and Dr. Mihir Bora, an associate consultant and hepatologist in Global Hospital, will join us today instead of Dr. Priyesh Patel. I have Dr. Ruhi Kohli, who is a chief liver intensivist, and RN Matthew John, who is a senior nurse in Global Hospital. I welcome you all. We have learned and experienced acute liver failure patients in our clinical areas all throughout our experience. Today, this topic finds its relevance in COVID-19 patients, as we have seen that many symptoms of liver injury are seen in some of these patients. Today, Kavita's presentation and case will also help us to find out how these patients or such a patient, whether they can go into an acute liver failure. We can also have some of the other discussion with our panelists today on the same topic. I welcome Ms. Kavita Shinde for her case presentation.
Thank you, Ms. Sini. Good afternoon, all. I would like to present the topic of acute liver failure. As we all know, in developed countries, the incidence of acute liver failure is 10 cases per year population per year. It occurs for 6% of all deaths due to liver diseases. The mortality rate for acute liver failure ranges between 56% to 80%. Viral hepatitis is the most common cause of acute liver failure worldwide. It is the prominent cause in ALF. So here we go with definition of acute liver failure. Acute liver failure is loss of liver function that occurs rapidly in days or weeks, usually in a person who has no pre-existing liver disease. It's most commonly caused by hepatitis virus or drugs such as acetaminophen. Next, we move on to causes of acute liver failure. There are multiple causes for acute liver failure. Here we begin with viral infections. As we all know, in India, hepatitis A, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, hepatitis E infections are most common that can lead to acute liver failure. Next, we move on to drugs. As anyone has given thought that paracetamol we took commonly and without any doctor's prescription and self-medication as a common drug. But paracetamol also can lead for acute liver failure. Also, medicines like AKT, which in this rifampicin is the drug which can derange your liver function test and may lead to acute liver failure. Also, halothane, herbal medications, which we use commonly for our small diseases like sneezing, coughing and all, but we never give thought that it can lead to acute liver failure. Some of the cryptogenic causes are non-A and non-B viral hepatitis. Some poisons like yellow phosphorus poison, mushroom toxicity, that can give leading cause of acute liver failure. Some miscellaneous causes are Wilson's disease, acute fatty liver, shock and congestive cardiac failure, liver metastasis and lymphoma. Acute liver failure can be managed by two modes of treatment, that is medical management and surgical management with transplant. The treatment modality is based on the King's College criteria for liver transplantation, which is used worldwide for listing acute liver failure patients for transplant. So here is the King's College criteria, which we use for ALF patient to listing acute liver failure. Acute liver failure in this mainly pH should be less than 7.5 and lactate should be more than 3. Some other categories we can use in that patient should be in grade 3 or grade 4 hepatic encephalopathy, INR more than 6.5, creatinine more than 3.4. Single criteria for ALF listing is INR more than 6.5 and any type of hepatic encephalopathy present. Some other criteria which we use is age less than 10, age less than more than 40 years, jaundice more than 7 days before development of encephalopathy, INR more than 3.5, serum bilirubin more than 17, some unfavorable etiology such as Wilson's disease, idiosyncratic drug reactions. Also, we use revised NHS criteria for ALF listing. In this category, one will be pH less than 7.24 after 24 hours of admission. Category 2 will be INR more than 6.5, creatinine more than 3, or anuria present, grade 3 to 4 hepatic encephalopathy. Category 3 will be arterial lactate on admission more than 5 or more than 4, 24 hours with hepatic encephalopathy. Category 4 would be criteria 2 and 3 from category 2, which clinical deterioration with raised intracranial pressure, FiO2 requirement increase more than 50%, and inotropic support increase. Category 5 will be clinical hepatic encephalopathy, INR more than 6.5, or 3 of the following, like age less than 10 years or more than 40 years, INR 3.5, jaundice to encephalopathy should be more than 7 days, and bilirubin should be 17.5 more. Category 6 will be unfavorable or non-paracetamol etiologies, seronegative or idiosyncratic drugs reactions. In this, it will be INR more than 6.5 or absence of hepatic encephalopathy, INR more than 2 with vitamin K repletion. two of the following, like age less than 10 and age less than 40, more than 40, INR more than 3.5. If hepatic encephalopathy is present, jaundice to encephalopathy should be more than 7 days and bilirubin should be more than 17.5. So here I'm going to present a very interesting case of a young female recovery from ALF. So Miss X was 23 years old female with no prior medical and surgical history, brought to Global Hospital Mumbai from private hospital at Surat with a history of retinol consumption approximately 25 grams on 27 September 2020. History of consumption was approximately 1 week prior to the admission to Global Hospital. Patient was initially taken to local hospital post-ingestion where symptomatic treatment was given. Patient was shifted to another hospital 2 days later in view of deterioration in liver function test. Like INR was increased to 5.53, ammonia had gone up to 92, SGOTs and SGPTs were in thousands. So their patient was treated with course of antibiotics, antacid, antiemetics, and anti-encephalopathy measures was done there. She was underwent dialysis as per the requirement. Thus, due to deranged LFT and increasing INR till 8.4, patient was shifted to Global Hospital for further management. On arrival to Global Hospital, patient's vitals were pupils to omen reacting, heart rate was 104 beats per minute, blood pressure was 110 by support of inotropic support of noradrenaline 0.14 mics, SpO2 was 100% with O2 by mass 5 liter, blood sugar was 72, temperature was 100.3 and GCS was 1515. So here we compare parameters of outside hospital and after admission. So HB was 16.8 on admission, like in a hospital of Global, it was 11.1. WBC was 6,700. In Global, it was 2,100. Platelet was 2.6 and in Global, it was 1.5. INR was 8.4. On admission, INR was 7.2. Triad was same like prior to admission. Ammonia outside hospital was 60. On admission, ammonia was 132. The bilirubin was 7.5, which had shown increasing trend of 8.3. Course of management in hospital was, on day one, routine investigation along with pan cultures was sent. PICO inserted for advanced hemodynamic monitoring and stabilization of the patient. On day one, routine investigations along with pan cultures was sent. PICO monitor with PICO inserted for advanced hemodynamic monitor and stabilization of the patient. Here PICO we have used for which PICO is helpful thing which enables for the patient's hemodynamic status to guide us for fluid therapy and vasoactive drug therapy, which will give us a cardiac output, stroke volume, preload, afterload, intrathoracic blood volume, extravascular lung index, which will help us to give fluid resuscitation and inotropic requirement support. Antibiotics were escalated as per the hospital protocol. On day two, INR was raised and hyperammonemia was there, 140. Cytokine storm was suspected, so first session of plasmapheresis was given. On day third, hepatic encephalopathy was worsened to grade 2 and INR was 7.2. So second session of plasmapheresis was given for the patient. On day 4, patient was stable as before. On day 5, hepatic encephalopathy worsened to grade 3 and ammonia was 141. So third session plasmapheresis was given. On day 6, patients were counted and patient listed and kept ready for SOS transplantation as patient had not shown any improvement. Gradually, patient had hemodynamically improved on day 6 evening till day 7. But on day 8, patient sudden deterioration in GCS was there and patient intubated in view of hepatic encephalopathy grade 3 to 4 and hemodynamic instability. So CRRT was started with extracorporeal therapy. Antibiotic escalated as patient had sputum culture which had shown Klebsiella pneumonia and blood culture of VRE growth. On day 10, patient improvement was there. Patient was conscious and hemodynamically better. Ammonia had reduced till 50 and so that we had discontinued CRRT. On day 11, patient was much better. So plan for extubation was there. And after extubation, patient was put on liquid diet. Encouragement for out-of-bed mobilization, physiotherapy was given and spirometry was given. On day 13 to day 14, all invasive lines were removed. Patient was shifted to ward. Monitoring of vital parameters and neurological observation was done. Day 15 to day 16, patient chest x-ray was done regularly to see if patient is getting overloaded with fluid. And on day 17 to 18, INR was 1.7. CT volumetry showed 900 cc, which is within normal limit. On day 19 to 20, patient was hemodynamically stable and was conscious, oriented without any complications, so discharged. The course of investigation from admission till discharge was, when patient came to hospital, INR was 7.42 with ammonia 92, SGOT, SGPT was higher side. Then ammonia was increasing till 141, 126. But on the day of discharge, patient gone home with INR of 1.8, ammonia of 30, SGOT of 67 and SGPT of 54. So medical management we do follow in our hospital for ALF patient is to maintain core temperature of 34 to 36 degree for maintaining peripheral circulation and whole body circulation. Mean arterial pressure should be more than 70 and less than 90 mm of Hg to have proper blood circulation. Central venous pressure should be 8 to 12 centimeter of HTO. It should not go below 8, that patient will have dehydration, or if it is goes more than 12, you need to worry, like patient can be overloaded and can lead to cerebral edema. PaCO2 should be 35 plus minus 2 mm of Hg. PaO2 should be range more than 90 and less than 120 mm of Hg. Ammonia should be less than 100 so that patient should not have any complication related hyperammonemia, like patient can go in hepatic encephalopathy. So measures we use here, we can start patient with Dufalac enema, CRRT SOS. Serum sodium should be 140 to 150. Standardization of the sodium maintenance. Deep sedation, here we are using RAS scale, Richmond Agitation Sedation Scale score. For ALS patients specifically, it should be minus 3 to minus 4. Patient should be in deep sedation. Patient will not get any stimulation and hence raised ICP measures will be maintained. Infusions like N-acetylcysteine to support liver function and IV dextrose 25% infusion will be given to maintain glycemic control. Blood investigations like ABG, ammonia, serum electrolytes, CBC, INR, calcium, phosphorus should be done on regular interval to check patient's improvement or deterioration in the patient's condition. Nursing management, we do take care for ALF patient like eye care, mouth care, nail care, hair care, foot care, back care, sponge bath, skin care. Skin care, we use foam dresses, olive oil application, etc. Use of SCD, sequential compression device, for prevention of DVT. BIS monitoring, here we use BIS monitoring is a specific thing we use in Global Hospital, which is introduced to see the qualitative EEG and assess the depth of anesthesia. For normal anesthesia, it should be less than 40, but in ALF patient, we maintain BIS monitoring should be 20 to 25. Here we check this counting. If nurses are the more working bedside people. So if it is going less than 20 or more than 25, nurses' responsibility to inform doctors and make sedation score accordingly. Monitor GCS and monitor patient pupils half an hourly. Also, we follow fast heartbeat strictly. We do follow F for feeding. Patient should get proper feeding within 24 to 48 hours. Proper analgesia maintenance should be there, so patient should not suffer. Sedation we follow according to patient's condition. Thromboprophylaxis, head up position to 30 to 35 degree. Ulcer prophylaxis, glycemic control we maintain 120 to 140. Spontaneous breathing trial, but in ALF patient, one should make sure that you don't give spontaneous breathing trial unless and until patient is stable. Bowel and bladder care, indwelling catheter removal, and de-escalation of antibiotics according to patient's need. Patient was discharged, and on discharge, patient's health education was given for watch daily weight management, salt restriction diet, as patient was ALF and can have chances of more sodium levels. Watch for drowsiness and breathlessness, and to do take proper follow on discharge. As we end, our team is our strength. We are not a team because we work together. We are a team because we respect, trust, and care for each other. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kavita, for that enlightening session, and it was a lovely case presentation. Really felt that the patient is in front of us and we need to run for that patient, taking care of that patient. Thank you very much. Our first question goes to Dr. Mihir Vora. Sir, can you share your views on what are the most common causes of ALF? And among the causes, if drugs is one, then what are the common drugs that causes ALF? How often do you get drug-induced ALF patients in your hospital? And how do you assess that the patient with ALF requires liver transplant?
Yeah, thank you, ma'am, for the presentation, and thank you for giving us a chance to answer. And apologies from Dr. Priyesh. So when an acute liver failure patient comes to the hospital, it is first very important for us to understand whether the person only has deranged liver enzymes, then we call it as hepatitis. If a person has deranged liver enzymes plus elevated INR, then we call it as liver injury. But if a patient has deranged liver enzymes plus rise in INR more than 1.5 and presents with encephalopathy, such patients are then called acute liver failure. So we first divide them into favorable or unfavorable etiology, because that has a lot of implications in prognosis. When I say favorable, means viral etiology or paracetamol as one of the causes. And when I say unfavorable, it means drug-induced liver injury or sometimes causes of Wilson's disease, sometimes acute flare of Budd-Chiari syndrome or autoimmune hepatitis. This becomes part of our unfavorable etiology. To assess any patient with acute liver failure, multiple scores came into picture, and Ms. Kavita enlightened nicely about all various scores which we take into account. But the most common one which people prefer is King's College criteria. It takes into account two things. One is paracetamol or non-paracetamol thing. And if I specifically talk about paracetamol, they are looking at if a person has pH which is less than 7.3, means we know that this patient may merit a transplant, or he's got an INR score more than 100 seconds, or his creatinine is more than 3.4, or is in grade 3, grade 4 encephalopathy. If we talk about something as non-paracetamol causes, which is one of the most common causes which we see in our hospital, we have a single point criteria where INR is more than 6.5, or 3 out of 5 criteria which we take into account where age is less than 10 or more than 40. They have an unfavorable etiology as one of the causes, like non-A, non-B, or drug-induced liver injury causes. Sometimes duration of jaundice to encephalopathy, if it is more than 7 days, or INR, which is more than 3.5, or our bilirubin is more than 17.5. Now, out of these 5, if 3 are positive, we say that this person fulfills King's College criteria. Either single point criteria, which is INR more than 6.5, or out of the 5 causes which we discussed, 3 have to be fulfilled. And if a person fulfills that, then these patients may need liver transplant in view of deterioration. There are some modifications which have been done to these criteria, and NHS came with various categories from 1 to 20. And it, as Ms. Kavita enlightened us, so there is unfavorable etiology and favorable. So it's category 5 and category 6. So I'm not going to discuss that, but this is what she discussed. There is also one more criteria which we follow is Alfred criteria, which we follow for our acute viral hepatitis patients, where we take into account 4 points: ammonia, bilirubin, INR, and encephalopathy. We check at the point of entry to our hospital, and we check at day 3. And if it's a rising trend as per points, and then we say that this patient fulfills the alphabet-based criteria and he merits, and we can register them for super urgent transplant. Now, coming back to the common etiologies which we see in our hospital, most common causes is acute viral hepatitis. Some patients do come with paracetamol toxicity. The common drug which we commonly see in our patients is tuberculosis, anti-tuberculosis treatment, sometimes anti-leprosy or anti-epilepsy. Many people come with complementary alternative medication, a short form which we use is CAM. In COVID era, we've had lots of cases of people taking Giloy. They may not always come with acute liver failure, but they come with acute liver injury. There are a few cases of yellow phosphorus toxicity, Wilson's disease. So these are the most common causes which people come to us. And if we take into data into account, we would have around more than 200 ALFs which have got admitted to us. And out of which around 55 to 60 patients would have undergone transplant, of which more than 10 patients were purely related to acute drug induced because of ATT. There were few patients of because of Ayurvedic treatment, which were around 15. And when we don't know the cause, man, we call it idiopathic cause, and which will form around 30% causes. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mihir. That was really enlightening and relevant to the present situation. Now over to Dr. Ruhi Kohli. Ma'am, can you say a few words on what is CRRT and does dialysis help in managing the patients with ALF? And also, what is the right time to consider transfer of an ALF patient to the transplant center?
Hello everybody, and a very good afternoon to everybody. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am,
you're audible.
Staircase.
Hello.
Continue.
Okay. So, good afternoon, everybody. And at the outset, I would like to thank everybody, all the delegates and all the moderators and the senior people from the nursing fraternity to have joined us this afternoon in this lovely webinar on liver nursing care. And I would like to congratulate our CNO Jessica for successfully conducting this. And I would also like take this opportunity to thank my entire nursing team, the nursing department, for doing such an amazing job out here at Global Hospital. Now, answering the questions which were put across to me, rightly mentioned by Ms. Kavita and Dr. Mihir, acute liver failure could be due to varied etiologies ranging from drug-induced to viral hepatitis, favorable, unfavorable, everything that has been spoken of. Now, what would be the right time for transfer of such a patient to tertiary care transplant center? Well, a lot of times liver transplant can be a life-saving procedure in a case of an acute liver failure patient. Hence, it is very important that these patients are managed at a transplant center. Doing so allows the patient to be evaluated by the transplant team in time to determine the candidacy for liver transplant while optimally managing medically the complications related to liver failure. So in my opinion, the right time would be at the onset of recognition. Like rightly pointed out by Dr. Mihir, there is something called as liver function derangement to liver injury and liver failure. The moment one sees that a patient is progressing from liver function derangement towards liver injury and the progression continues, I think this is the right time to shift such a patient to a liver transplant center so that the evaluation begins on time and the complications are tackled in the right and timely manner. This is the answer to the first question.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, I have heard that the nurses in Global Hospital do manage CRRT in their ICU on their own. Is that true?
That is very much true, and that is a very commendable job that they do. It is amazing that they have taken over the renal replacement therapy procedure completely here in our hospital, and they are very confidently and independently handling all the renal replacement therapies. Well, we call it renal replacement therapy, but more often than not, it is given due to liver and metabolic indications and not for the renal indications. So yes, I would proudly like to say that my team of excellent nurses handles this very confidently.
A big clap to Global Hospital nurses for that. Ma'am, also, can you share a few indications for Flex?
So plasma exchange or PLEX or plasma pheresis, as we call it, the indication for a PLEX in liver failure, well, the predominant mechanism which is responsible for the development of multi-organ failure. As we all know, acute liver failure is a very dynamic disease, and it can the complications can range from one to a multiple organ failure in an acute liver failure patient. And the mechanism responsible for the development of multi-organ failure, hepatic encephalopathy, in this case is an overwhelming systemic immune response, which is triggered by the release of pro-inflammatory cytokines and DAMPs due to massive necrosis of the hepatocytes. Now, extracorporeal removal of these molecules has shown to have beneficial effects in controlling and managing the complications related to these release of cytokines and the multi-organ failure. It works in two ways. It replaces the excretory and metabolic function of the failing liver by supplementing the lacking proteins and replacement of the plasma factors which attenuate to the inflammatory response. And it also removes the deleterious DAMPs and the cytokines, thus improving the patient's hemodynamic. I would like to also point out at the same time that this process helps in stabilization of the patient's hemodynamics, but this stabilization is quite transient, and it just lasts as long as the release of fresh cytokines again starts to cause the cytokine storm and the systemic inflammatory response system. But it helps us to buy time until then. So that really works. Plasma exchange can be of three kinds. The high volume plasma exchange, very commonly practiced in the Western world. The standard volume plasma exchange and the low volume plasma exchange, which is particularly done by us here in Global Hospital. And that is our unit protocol, basically. So that is what we do.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much for those inputs. It was really knowledgeable. My next question is to Dr. Prashanta Rao. Sir, can you share how do you evaluate donor and recipient in your hospital, and is it different from other patients? And is ALF transplant surgery very different from other cirrhotic surgeries?
Thank you very much, organizers, for giving us an opportunity to be part of this wonderful webinar. Welcome to all our nurses and our administrative colleagues. So, the way we evaluate the donor and the recipient, well, the donor evaluation, be it for a standard liver transplant, living donor liver transplant, versus a living donor liver transplant for an acute liver failure patient, essentially is the same. There is no shortcuts or no evaluation steps are bypassed. The only thing is the normal evaluation that is done over a period of 3 to 4 days is all squeezed into 12 to 24 hours. So our nurse coordinators who are evaluating these donors and patients run around over 12 to 24 hours continuously, be it day, be it night. They stay overnight essentially and finish the evaluation the night. So when we go home in the evening, evaluation is starting. By the time we are back in the morning, the donor is ready for surgery. So it's an exceptional thing that is done. So essentially it is the same. Evaluation is done in multiple steps. First step is some basic test to look at the liver function, kidney function, confirm the blood group, etc. Next step is the CT scan, which essentially is of two types. One is to determine the amount of fat in the liver, and the next is the contrast CT to evaluate how are the blood vessels of the liver, what is the size of the liver, is the amount that is going to be taken from the donor enough for the patient, and more importantly, the amount that is going to be left behind in the donor, is it safe for the donor or no? Following that, there's an MRI, which is done to look at the anatomy of the bile ducts of the liver and to also reconfirm the amount of fat in the liver. And from that point of time, if all these tests are okay from the liver point of view, the individual is fit to donate the part of the liver. The next step is to evaluate their fitness to undergo any kind of surgery. So essentially it involves cardiac evaluation, pulmonary evaluation, the psychiatric evaluation, which is the most important in this aspect of living donor liver transplant. And then of course, once all the doctors have cleared, the main part is the legal committee approval and paperwork for that. And once that is done, we proceed for the surgery. From the patient perspective, the evaluation of a patient of acute liver failure undergoing transplant is much different, I would say, from that of a standard liver transplant patient, because the extensive evaluation that we do for a standard cirrhotic is not possible because the patient is very sick, he's on the ventilator, he's on CRRT, as Rui and Mia just said, and sometimes on blood pressure support medicines also. So essentially, it consists of one, you look for contraindications to transplant, look for indications for transplant, and fitness for transplant. The indication is the etiology, whether they meet the King's College criteria or the revised NHS criteria, like Kavita sister just pointed out a short while ago. Second thing is contraindications to transplant. We look at presence of infection in the form of cultures, pan cultures that are sent from the patient at the time of admission, PCT, the CT chest. These are the contraindications. And then in the setting of fitness, we would do a 2D echo to make sure there are no gross other problems which we will be missing and we will have a problem on table. So that's about it for evaluation of patient. Well, the next question is the surgery of an acute liver failure patient different from that of cirrhotic? So I would say yes. The first, the surgery is essentially of two parts. One is the donor operation, one is the recipient operation, right? So the donor operation remains the same. There is no difference between the two. From the patient operation also is of two parts, I can say. First part is taking out the damaged liver and the second part is putting in the new liver. So putting in the new liver essentially remains the same, be it a cirrhotic patient or a transplant being done for an acute liver failure patient. But the first part, that is the taking out the damaged liver, I would say is significantly different. In a patient of cirrhosis, there is a lot of portal hypertension, the platelet counts are low, the liver might be shrunken, lot of collaterals might be there because of the portal hypertension. So these things are there because of which the surgery is much more difficult with respect to the portal hypertension, the chance of bleeding from the small blood vessels of the portal vein. In the acute liver failure patient, the challenge is a completely different challenge. Here there is not much portal hypertension, it's clean planes. But the challenge is that basically it's a necrotic liver which is sitting inside and causing lot of SIRS, or systemic immune inflammatory response, leading to hemodynamic instability. The moment we move the liver, touch the liver, you will start, the anesthetist will tell us if the blood pressure is coming down, there is some bradycardia. So we have to do a clamp the portal inflow, all the vascular inflow to the liver has to be clamped, and then we have to do a very rapid, a fast hepatectomy so that the hemodynamic stains are not there. And then of course, to minimize the, as you can imagine, once the portal inflow is clamped, all the blood which is coming back from the intestine cannot go ahead. So the bowel gets congested, which is again not a good thing. So we do a temporary portocaval shunt, so I have to divert the blood to the intestine. And that is how we manage these patients during the surgery. So that is, I would say, the difficult or different part as compared to a cirrhotic transplant.
Thank you, sir. A big clap to the Global Hospital nurses and the doctors and a great team without which it cannot happen, I'm sure.
Yes, the ICU nurses, the floor nurses, as well as our nurse coordinators. Unless these three limbs play their appropriate roles, no matter how good the surgery be done, it would not be a good outcome.
Yes, yes, truly, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, my next question goes to R.N. Matthew. Matthew, 2 decades ago, ALF survival outcome was around 50%, but now it's 80%. How can nursing management bring out a change in the outcome in ALF?
Good evening, all. Thank you for the question. Nurses in 21st century are known for advancement in nursing care. With increased criticality, nurses caring for ALF, the care has definitely improvised from what was given 2 decades ago. We nurses are focused on hemodynamic monitoring, strict infection control practices, hemodynamic monitoring, as well as the monitoring ABG parameters. The nurses are competent to identify any deviation in patient health condition, which is quickly identified and escalated to the doctors.
Okay, thank you. Matthew, also one more question to you. What are the different life-threatening complications of ACLF and how do we manage them from a nursing perspective?
If the ALF patients have risk of developing complications like cerebral edema, sepsis, and multi-organ failure. We manage the cerebral edema by elevating the patient head to 30 degree and neck in neutral position. Maintain the calm environment, avoiding the overhydration by means of advanced hemodynamic monitoring such as PICO. We can keep close watch and control over fluid status, thus avoid the cerebral edema. For prevention of sepsis, from the time of admission, we may maintain patient in contact isolation. Then second, rectal swab sent for CRE. If report come for positive, continue on contact isolation. And if report come for negative, we switch over to protective isolation and continue practicing the strict situation control practices. For the third complication of multi-organ failure, avoid extracorporeal therapies like SLED, CRRT, and plasmapheresis. With quality nursing care, we nurses can make big difference for ALF patient outcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms. Matthews. My last and final question before we end the session is to Ms. Kavita. As you have been working as a liver and transplant ICU manager for many years and have been an expert in this field, what do you think are the basic qualities a nurse requires to provide best nursing care to an ALF patient?
Thank you for the question, ma'am. As we all know, nurses are the heart of the hospital and doctors are the head of the hospital. The basic quality that nurse should have is empathy. Then only she can work wholeheartedly for patient. Also, she has to be compassionate, dedicated, proactive, quick responsive, compassionate towards her work. Also, a nurse taking care of ALF need to be competent enough as well as should be decisive to escalate any changes in patient's condition immediately. A complete knowledge of infection care bundles plays a vital role in preventing complications for the patient and hence good recovery and outcome of the patient. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kavita. Thank you everyone on this panel and Ms. Kavita too for having a lovely discussion and it was really enlightening. And I would like to hand over the rest of the session to Ms. Rashmi. Thank you.
Thank you all panel expertise for very informative and interactive session today. Moving on to next panel discussion, I invite our panel to expertise speaker and moderator, Ms. Sweety Maman. Ms. Sweety Maman is a nurse educator in Jupiter Hospital, Thane. She has 11 years of experience in the field of nursing. She is MSc in nursing in medical surgical nursing. She is a key speaker, resource person for various national nursing conferences. She is certified AHA-ACLS BLS care provider. She has anchored over 50 national level, state level, educational and corporate conferences. Over to you, Ms. Sweety. Ms. Sweety, please unmute yourself. Yeah.
Sweety, we are unable to. Sweety, we are unable to hear you. Is it okay?
Yes. Audible, clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now? Hello? Am I audible now? Can someone just respond?
Yes, we can.
Thank you. Extremely sorry for the inconvenience. Yeah, so thank you, Ms. Rashmi, for the wonderful introduction. A famous writer, Benjamin Franklin, once quoted, "An investment in knowledge pays the best interest." So thank you, Global Team and Annie, for helping us to pay our installments. As a proud Annie member, with a great pleasure, let me take the privilege to introduce the speaker and the panelists for a very interesting session on alcohol hepatitis. To begin with, let me introduce the presenter for today, very enterprising, RN Sabreesan M, a very energetic and resourceful nurse manager, liver and transplant ICU, Global Hospitals. Amongst our expert panelists, we have Dr. Amit Gupte, consultant in hepatology, Dr. Anurag Shrimal, consultant, hepatobiliary and pancreatic and liver transplant lead surgeon, Dr. Ruhi Kohli, chief liver intensivist, and RN Pallavi Munde, senior nurse, Global Hospitals, Mumbai. Let's begin the session with the case presentation. As you all know, alcoholic liver disease is a major cause of alcohol-related morbidity and mortality. Its presentation ranges from fatty liver to alcohol hepatitis, cirrhosis, and hepatocellular carcinoma. Although alcoholic hepatitis is an acute condition, majority of the patients, by the time they come for consultation, would be in a very advanced stage requiring a liver transplant. So a similar case is presented by RN Sabreesan. Over to you, Mr. Sabreesan, for a deeper dive on alcoholic hepatitis. All the best.
Thank you, ma'am, for your wonderful introduction. Good evening, one and all. Today, I'm going to present a topic on alcoholic hepatitis-related chronic liver disease. Chronic hepatitis, alcoholic hepatitis is a hepatitis occurred due to excess intake of alcohol. Normally, people who is taking heavy alcohol intake, typically 8 to 10 drinks per day for decades. It is usually found when heavy alcohol is taken, a normal liver changes to fatty liver. This fatty liver leads to fibrosis and further leading to end-stage liver cirrhosis. Now I would like to discuss about liver donor liver transplant. Liver donor liver transplant is the replacement of a diseased liver with the healthy liver from another person. It's called allograft. What is allograft? The transplant of an organ or tissue from one individual to another of the same faces with a different genotype. This is the normal anatomical liver that includes inferior vena cava, hepatic artery, portal vein, and biliary tract. A portion is retrieved from the donor and is implanted to the recipient. Now, we will going through process of management of alcoholic hepatitis related chronic liver disease patient, pre and post transplant management, and journey of better outcome. On 2nd November 2020, Mr. X, 44 years old male, resident of Mumbai, was transferred from a private hospital to Global Hospital Mumbai with the complaints of fever, anorexia, vomiting, abdominal discomfort, and altered sensorium. During data collection, we found out that patient was admitted in private hospital since 27 October 2020, there he was diagnosed as alcoholic hepatitis. There he was treated with steroids for 10 days. Later he was detected with a sepsis and coagulopathy and was shifted to Global Hospital Mumbai for further management. He was a chronic alcohol since last 15 years, about 6 to 8 drinks per day. And he also was smoking since last 6 years. Physical assessment. And performing the physical assessment, his vitals were temperature 99.2 degree Fahrenheit, heart rate, tachycardia, and BP is normal, saturation is 95% with 2 liter of O2. On neurological assessment, patient GCS was 13/15 and hepatic encephalopathy grade 1 and 2. Per abdomen soft and distended. As per now, we move on to diagnostic findings. USG. USG shows gallstone with changes of hepatitis, ascites, portal hypertension, and splenomegaly. MRCP shows diffuse hepatic steatitis with multiple GB calculi. MRI liver shows GB calculi with the free fluid in the abdomen, acute kidney injury, and cirrhosis and enlarged liver. 2D echo is normal. Pre-transplant autoimmune workup was done, which result showed all negative result, ANA, ANSMA, and LKMI. Next, the laboratory investigation showed on admission, the WBC counter was 30,000 and CRP was 76. There were some changes during hospital course. The HP was 7.4 and INR was 1.89. And before transplant, that count was reduced, become normal, 6,960 and INR 1.60 and CRP was 33. Diagnosis, alcoholic hepatitis related, chronic liver disease, portal hypertension, moderate ascites, and cardiac tamponade. Medical management, now we move on to medical management for hemodynamic management, monitor vitals and intake output, fluid and nutrition management. On nutrition, we started NJ feed slowly and then gradually increased as tolerance. As per cardiopulmonary management, patient had undergone pericardiosynthesis. During that period, the patient had received single vasopressor support for few days. And patient had received oxygen therapy, chest physiotherapy, and mobilization. Our nurses were taking of that spirometry every second hourly and mobilization. Hepatic encephalopathy management, monitor GCS every hourly using anti-hepatic encephalopathy measures. Then hepatic encephalopathy management moved on the next, sepsis management. Sepsis management, one initial stage patient had sepsis, we treated with antibiotic and antifungal therapy. In renal management, we managed with the fluid restriction, 1 to 1.5 liter per day, and fold is catheterized for patient for monitoring intake output and with the help of diuretic therapy. Then cardiac tamponade management, the 2D echo shows pericardial effusion, and during that time we did emergency pericardiosynthesis pictal catheterization insertion. That fluid aspirated 450 to 500 ml in hemorrhagic fluid, monitor drain color and output every fourth hourly. Monitoring coagulation profile, monitor INR and thromboelastography, correct coagulation with Fresenius plasma, random RDP, random donor platelet, and cryoprecipitate. With administration of recombinant human coagulation factor 7. Then surgical management, we planned for liver donor, liver transplant. His wife was selected as a donor after the multidisciplinary team evaluation. Preoperative assessment for recipient. After a patient get readmissions, started from the multidisciplinary team evaluations and given fitness, then sent, we did RT-PCR, which was negative. After that, he was discussed to take transplant. All the necessary consent we were obtained. We nurses sent all pre-op blood investigations, cultures, radiology investigations, and also blood reservation done. We nurses give bath, chlorodexin sponge bath for 3 times before surgery as per given duration. Patient kept nil per oral 12 hours, preoperative medications and antibiotics given as per physician orders. Pre-op consent for recipient on details that are required to be taken, surgery team and anesthesia team. On surgery team, video consent, high risk consent, general consent, and transplant consent. On anesthesia team, pre-anesthesia evaluation and consent, anesthesia critical care consent, and blood transfusion consent. Next, we move on to intraoperative events for recipient. Where the patient is given general anesthesia followed by intubations and placed invasive lines, the team up to end monitoring vitals and laboratory investigations based on correct the values. Then begin the surgical procedure where ascitic fluid was removed 1.3 liter and pericardial drain fluid removed 250 ml and also removed explanted liver around 2 kg. Then the patient had intraoperative blood loss around 700 ml for which he was transfused to CRBC and 20% of albumin 100 ml. Before closure, we did Doppler and confirmed patency of hepatic artery and portal vein flow. Then placed perihepatic drain, donor liver, replaced anastomosis done. The graft weight is 830 gram and GRWR ratio. It means the graft ratio divided by patient ratio 1.06. More than 0.06 is normal GRWR for the adult. Postoperative management for recipients. We have some set of protocol for postoperative patients, especially donor and recipient. On the day of surgery, after surgery, patient shifted to liver transplant intensive care unit with mechanical ventilation support with adequate anesthesia and analgesia. Then the ABG monitoring is done till lactate comes to below 2. And if lactate shows decreased trend, we do ABG every fourth hourly. We use PICO. PICO means it pulse induced continuous cardiac output monitoring for all recipient and monitoring cardiac and fluid status and lung volumes of the patient based on administering IV fluids and monitoring intake output. On postoperative day 1, we monitoring liver function test and portal vein Doppler values to evaluate graft function. Then started steroid immunosuppressant and low molecular weight heparin therapy. Antibiotic therapy continued till culture reports. Then we gave sedation, vacation, and extubation. We followed fast track beds to ensure the patient does not get hospital acquired infections. Post extubation give chest physiotherapy and spirometry to prevent lung collapse and improved oxygen level. On postoperative day two, based on pre-op cultures, reports de-escalation of antibiotics, nurses encouraged patient to continue active and passive exercise with the help of physiotherapy. The post-op day of three, we used to start NJ feed and oral diet for this patient. We delined all vascular access before delining. We ensure patient vitals are stable. And post-op day 8 to 11, drains are removed, fluid diet started with high protein and high caloric diet. Monitoring cyclosporine level and clinically improvement seen, the patient neurological status was good. And post-operative day 12, plan for discharge and blood investigation sent. The reports were showing normal. Then finalized the graft function is normal. Then planned discharge. Education and surgical wound care panel. On discharge instruction, keep wound open, clean and dry at all time. Immunosuppression medication should be taken at the fixed time. Do not skip doses. Drug levels, tacrolimus or cyclosporine should be checked as per physician order. During periods of maximal immunosuppression, avoid crowds to minimize exposure to respiratory illness. Timely blood investigations going follow up to repeat for 6 months to 1 year. Mr. X had required with the best care provided by our expert team and has started living his second life. He assured the nurse that he would not restart drinking. I'm a nurse. These eyes have seen pain. This hand have touched hearts. This heart has felt brokenness. These feet have walked a 1,000 miles. All for our patients. I am a nurse. Thank you.
Thank you, Arun Sabrishan. And the last few lines of the poem were really inspiring, motivating for every nurse, actually. It was a very vivid and explicit case presentation, and the PPTs were so good. It really reminded me of some Black Brunner or medical surgical nursing textbook. Really well made and well presented. Thank you for that. So it's a time to hear from our experts. My first question is for Dr. Anurag Shrimal. So as we have seen in this case also, by the time the patient came, there were many changes. There was steatitis, there was cirrhotic changes in the liver. So does all the patients of alcoholic hepatitis come at such later stage, and do they all need to undergo a transplant? And if they have to undergo a transplant, is there any bracket or eligibility criteria they need to fit into?
Okay. So patients with alcoholic liver disease, they can present at various stages of liver disease. They can present with just alcoholic hepatitis. Even early on, they can present with just steatosis, just fatty liver, or alcoholic hepatitis, or the patients who have much worse, very severe alcoholic hepatitis, to patients with acute chronic liver disease, so various presentations. Now, this particular case presented quite late in terms of the onset of the disease physiology. The patient already had cirrhosis and on top of that had alcoholic hepatitis. Coming to the next question, that which subset of these patients require management? Okay, so I think Dr. Amit Gupta would highlight about the medical management of patients with alcoholic liver disease or alcoholic hepatitis. But in a group of patients where, say, this is the first presentation of them presenting to the hospital with a very severe alcoholic hepatitis, we evaluate their psychosocial status as to what are the chances of them going back to alcohol, how is the family support. And only in a select group of patients who have a very sound psychosocial support, along with that, who have failure of medical therapy. So say these patients receive steroids and their Lilly score at the end of the week continues to be high, higher than 0.45. All the patients were completely ineligible for medical therapy. These are the patients who have infection, acute kidney injury, GI bleed, or other contraindications for the use of high-dose steroids. In that select subgroup of patients, so what I mean is that first presentation, patients who have a very sound psychosocial support system, cleared by the psychiatric evaluation, along with that, there is a failure of medical therapy. So these are the group of patients who, if we try to manage conservatively, have got a very high mortality, almost 30 to 60% mortality in 30 days. And this is a subgroup of patients who would benefit out of a liver transplant.
Thank you, sir, for that very brief and simple question. My question, next question is to Dr. Ruhi. Dr. Ruhi, you're a chief liver intensivist. So would you like to add any more points in the inclusion criteria for the transplant?
Once again, a very good afternoon, everybody. So I guess my colleague, Dr. Anurag here, has very nicely put all the criteria together in terms of indication for transplant and alcoholic hepatitis. More often than not, what we experience in our day-to-day clinical setting is that these patients come to us very late in the course of the disease. It's pointed out in the presentation of Mr. Sabreesan, this particular patient also presented to us quite late in the course of the disease, where the alcoholic hepatitis was there, along with already present chronic liver disease, along with its complications. The chronic liver disease had also decompensated by the time this patient had come to us. So these patients are quite complicated with a complex range of organ failures involved in the disease by the time they reach us. So there are very few select patients who come to us early where we can give them probably a chance to recover with pure medical management and abstinence and good nutrition support. Majority of the patients come so late that there is very little for us to offer. Just like Dr. Anurag rightly pointed, steroids is the only pharmacological option available in such patients. However, the use of steroid is limited by the potential adverse effects. It has quite unpredictable benefits. And unfortunately, this group of patients have a very high 30-day mortality of 30 to 60%. Hence,
చూస్తే
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. You're audible, ma'am.
Yeah.
Please continue.
So, so these patients have a very high 30-day mortality, around 30 to 60%. And hence, they leave no other option but to assess and evaluate them for liver transplant, given the fact economic support, a good family support, and also the fact because in our country, the most common transplant that we are because of the shortage of available deceased donors across our country. So that is another factor we need to keep in mind, that this particular patient should not go back to taking alcohol, where we are subjecting a healthy individual to such a major surgery just to save his life. So we also have to ensure that, hence a proper thorough psychiatric evaluation also becomes very necessary in such a case.
Dr. Ruhi, I have one more question for you. Ma'am, post-liver transplant, see, when the patient is coming with alcoholic hepatitis, they would be having a habit of chronic alcoholism. So when you are treating them in the ICU, initially they would be under the effect of sedation, they would be on ventilator, but when they come out of this sedation, when they are weaned off from the ventilator, do they exhibit withdrawal symptoms? And how do you manage it in the ICU?
Alcoholic withdrawal syndrome is a very, it's a very common and a very purely protocolized or understood syndrome. There is no guideline or protocol to manage such a syndrome. It consists of a set of symptoms that occur due to sudden cessation of alcohol, because these patients have been used to drinking alcohol on a daily basis for a very, very long time altogether. So they are at a risk of developing alcohol withdrawal syndrome. Such patients, usually when they come to us very sick and we need to put them on the ventilation, it's very easy in the initial course, but as they come off the ventilation, it is very necessary that we manage pathy, but also the withdrawal syndrome, because more often than not, these two go hand in hand. Our goal, apart from the management of the nutritional deficit, because that is the biggest challenge in these alcoholic hepatitis patients. Nutrition is a big unmet challenge, and which needs to be definitely taken care of. There are a lot of electrolyte derangements which we need to tackle here. In terms of pharmacological therapy, benzodiazepines are the only pharmacological therapy which have always been, until the recent past, used in managing alcohol withdrawal. However, the limitation with the use of benzodiazepine in a liver patient or a patient with a deranged liver enzyme is that benzodiazepine is metabolized through liver. And in the presence of a liver disease, it causes prolonged duration of action and has a lot of side effects in terms of over-sedation, leading to the risk of aspiration, requiring intubation mechanical ventilation, which further leads to an increase in the length of ICU stay, length of hospital stay, increased hospital costs, which is a huge challenge in our country. Hence, with the introduction of newer drugs like dexmedetomidine, people to use in such patients because it does not cause any respiratory depression, but at the same time it definitely helps us handle with the anxiety, the delirious, the hallucination, and the tremors which is associated with the withdrawal symptoms. So I think dexmedetomidine is a very, very effective and a very, very good drug which is now available with us, which was not there earlier on, and that is how we are able to manage these withdrawal symptoms in a much better way.
Thank you, Dr. Ruhi. Well explained. My question is to Dr. Anurag Shrimal. Sir, transplant is a very long procedure. In this case, also presented by Mr. Sabreesan, we have seen that in intra-op, there was a lot of fluid loss, ascitic fluid being removed, long procedures. So when these patients come to CCU, okay, so what are the crucial points to be considered, monitored, and escalated in the immediate post-operative period in critical care units?
That's a very important question, and I think this applies to all patients post-transplant, not just the patients with acute alcoholic hepatitis. So during their transplant, one is that whenever these patients have acute alcoholic hepatitis, their liver is quite big, they have hepatocalcemia, as well as the liver is quite stiff. Because of that, and their underlying coagulopathy, the blood loss may be quite significant as compared to a straightforward transplant. Mobilization of the liver itself may cause challenges, and these patients may also develop hemodynamic instability in the process of hepatectomy. Once we tide over this period, then these patients are shifted to the ICU. We have a very detailed protocol to monitor them, and our nurses, the ICU nurses, they are very skilled at managing these protocols. So these includes good ventilatory support, monitoring their vital parameters. Now, very important, as you would have seen in the presentation by Mr. Sabrishan, that we do their PICO every 2 hours, and that gives us the best possible fluid status at the cardiac output monitoring of these patients. We monitor their vitals, their blood sugars. We do their arterial blood gas frequently to monitor their lactates as to how well the liver is working and how the lactates are coming down. The bedside nurses are also monitoring their intake and output, fluid balance, as well as they keep a very close eye at the drains as to what is the nature of the surgical drains. Has it become more bloody at any point of time? We do periodic Dopplers for them in the immediate post-operative period, that is to look for the patency of all the blood vessels that we have joined. Along with that, most of these patients might have renal failure, and they may require renal replacement therapy. So then again, the role of CRRT would come in picture in this group of patients. And over the next few days, they will be started on immunosuppression and monitoring them with the therapeutic drug monitoring in the form of tacrolimus level is very, very important. Once these patients are extubated, even monitoring their neurological status, so subtle changes in their mood, in their confusion, can be the very early signs. These patients are also at a higher risk of developing intracranial events in the form of bleed, and hence monitoring their pupils it becomes very, very important. So, the monitoring of these patients in the immediate post-transplant period is very, very crucial for a successful outcome of their transplant.
Thank you so much, sir, for that very simplified explanation. Herculean task for the nurses, indeed. Hello? Herculean task for the nurses, indeed, to have a monitoring of everything and timely escalation. And if the presentation by Mr. Sabrish and the patient could go home, it was a result of a wonderful teamwork by the entire team. So my next question is to Dr. Amit Gupte. You're a consultant in hepatology. Throughout the panel discussions, throughout the explanations, all of them were telling about a narrow bracket of the medicines that can be used for these patients. Okay, so liver and metabolism go hand in hand. Hence, there can be restrictions to medical management. So how do we plan and execute medical management for the post-transplant patients?
So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. So basically, Dr. Anurag and Dr. Ruhi have discussed most of the pharmacotherapy of alcoholic hepatitis. What is most important, most efficacious, and probably the most safe sort of management is nutrition. So nutrition is essentially the backbone of all the therapy of alcoholic hepatitis. And it is easy to administer also and has to be ensured. So usually these patients have already are in a hypermetabolic state, and their caloric requirements would be much higher than a normal person. So usually it is an effort to be made to supplement them with those much of calories. So usually 2000 to 2500 kilocalories per day and a high protein diet are two things that are absolutely essential for adequate recovery of these patients. Other important thing is feeding at regular intervals. So these patients who have got alcoholic hepatitis or even decompensated liver disease, the glycogen stores in the liver are depleted. So they cannot tolerate long periods of fasting. So in case of prolonged period of fasting, the muscle proteins undergo lysis and they go more and more into sarcopenia. So it is important to feed them at regular intervals, and especially a nighttime snack is something is really important that we have to ensure, and the nurses can play a vital role in ensuring that these patients get that nighttime snack. Approximately 700 kilocalories of nighttime snack is what is recommended. And that can go a long way in the immediate as well as in the long-term management of these patients. Apart from that, as we already discussed, steroids are something that have been shown to alter the course of acute severe alcoholic hepatitis. And there are criteria based on whether a patient is eligible for steroids or not eligible for steroids, whether there are any contraindications like GI bleed, pancreatitis, or any active sepsis present or not. And even if we give steroids, we assess the response, whether a patient has responded to steroids or not. And accordingly, the further management has to be taken care of. But the most important thing, as I would like to repeat again and again, is nutrition. And my colleagues, especially the nurses, have a very vital role to play in this part.
Thank you, sir. We really understand our role. And congratulations to Global Team for executing very well. So takeaway message is timely management of the complications and meeting the calorie requirements with other medical managements. Okay, so my last two question is to Ms. Pallavi. Ms. Pallavi, Arant Sabrisan had really explained a lot on care of a recipient. Okay, so whenever there is a transplant, one more person who comes into picture is a donor who have taken that decision that I'm donating my liver to the other person. So what are the pre- and post-operative management for a donor?
Good evening, all. Thank you, ma'am, for questioning me. As the donor has done great deed donating an organ, we as a nurses doing our daily care need to acknowledge, they appreciate the donor. Pre-operative care, psychological reassurance we are taking, investigation as per hospital protocol, preoperative health teaching, breathing exercise, use of spirometry, arranging for Flotron and DVT for prevent DVT, arranging blood product for before shifting OT. Post-operative care, post-operative monitoring of all vital parameters, fluid challenges as per patient requirement, monitoring lactate, intake output monitoring, extubation after 8 hours, out of bed mobilization, and the following day walking will be inches early recovery of the donor. In addition, frequent chest CT and limb physiotherapy should be supported the donor. With regards to diet, post-operatively, once extubated, observation for 4 hours, begin sips of water, if tolerating, begin liquid diet, then switch to soft diet, afterwards full diet. Plan for pain management. Once the off-key role transplant nurses has the focus on in order to keep donor comfortable and speedily recovery. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. So let's take a moment to bow and give respect to every person who takes a decision to donate their organs, and especially a bow to every person who have pledged to donate their organ. And if any one of you have not done it, is a time that understanding the need of the hour, let's all pledge to donate organs. Yes, so nursing is a comprehensive care, holistic care. It does not end with a in the ICU or in the or in a ward or a non-critical unit. We are also giving a very good discharge education. As per Sabreesan's presentation also, we have seen a number of points he have listed down. So can you also tell us about discharge education of post-transplant patient, particularly transplant post-alcoholic hepatitis patients?
As we know, all liver transplant patient post-operative care as same, but alcoholic hepatitis, one most patient not to drink alcohol as part of their treatment. Nurses need to counsel and provide psychological motivation on daily basis. Now, transplant patient needs to take normal diet with no fluid restriction, salt restriction not required. If anybody have high BP, then salt restriction is most important. Avoid pasteurization milk and meats. Avoid lifting heavy weights above 5 kg for 3 months. Avoid stenosis activity for 3 months. Keep wound open and clean. Drug levels. Regular follow up, taking immunosuppressants, suppressants, fixed time and frequency, and should be checked at acrolamus level and cyclosporin level. Order. Regular follow up with the doctors during periods. Maximum immunosuppressive. Avoid crowded places and exposure of respiratory illness. Following guidelines plays an important role in successful outcomes.
Okay, so that brings us to the closing of the session on alcohol hepatitis. A big thank you to RN Sabreesan and all the dignified experts who have given and their valuable time and enlightened us. Thank you, everyone, and a special thank you to my CNO, Vinci ma'am, for grooming me and providing me this significant opportunity. Thank you. Over to you, Ms. Rashmi.
Thank you, respected panel expertise, for very enriching session today. Moving on to today's last panel discussion, I invite our all panel expertise, speaker and moderator, Dr. Shobha Gaikwad. Dr. Shobha Gaikwad is assistant professor in LT College of Nursing, SNDT Women's University, Mumbai. She is 29 years of experience in nursing, PhD in nursing, MSc in CVTS nursing, MA in sociology. She also is postgraduate diploma in education management. She has published 30 papers in peer-reviewed and impact factor UGC recognized journals. She has bagged first prize for scientific paper presentation at various international and national conferences. She received first prize for concept mapping. She has guided 6 postgraduates who secured research awards. She again bagged second prize for best PG category at SNDT Inter-University Avishkar Research Convention. Over to you, Dr. Shobha.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
But I'm not able to share my video. So if you can give me the rights to share my video. Okay. So first and foremost, let me thank the global team, Annie Maharashtra, for inviting me to this panel. Okay. I would just like to share that with LTCN, I'm proud that in 2016-17, with the global team, as part of the Tarangan Alumni Association, LTCN, we had conducted the first heart conference with the global. When Ms. Prajakta was heading the global, Then in 2017-18 again, when Miss Pearl was heading, that time we conducted the first heart-lung conference. And now with the Miss Jessica in the team, we are doing again liver conference, though it is not under Tarangan, but again associated with Miss Tankam and with the Annie Maharashtra and global again. So I think global is going way ahead with each and every organ. Okay. So moving forward, as we know that my particular panel is on acute on chronic liver failure. So as per the European Association Consortium guideline, when we talk about acute on chronic liver failure, it's a syndrome. It's a syndrome that develops in patient with cirrhosis and is characterized by what? That is on acute decompensation, organ failure, and high short-term mortality. One-third of short patients who are hospitalized for ACLF with acute decompensation presents with ACLF on admission or develops the syndrome during hospitalization. And when we talk about it, it is considered as a major worldwide medical problem with prevalence rate at risk population in the region of 20 to 35%. The worldwide reported mortality of ACLF ranges between 30 to 50% and closely relates mostly with the number of organ failure. That's the reason this is the part of this panel of presentation which is kept by global team. So let us just see who are our panel member. Can we have the screen share, please? Okay, so we have an expert panel given to us by the global team. The presenter who will be having an excellent case presenter by senior nurse LICU, that is Ms. Ashwati Pillai, and then an excellent mix of doctors and nurses, which is headed by Dr. Akash Shukla, consultant hepatology, who will take up our questions. Dr. Mihir Vora, who was there and I in an earlier panel too, associate consultant hepatology. Dr. Ravi Mohanka, who doesn't know him, chief surgeon and head liver transplantation, but due to some immediate commitment, he'll not be with us. And Dr. Prasanta Rao will be joining us in this particular panel. And then our dynamic Supriya Hetambe, who will be talking to us and taking up our question, and she is an excellent MICU nurse manager. So now I hand over to Ms. Ashwati Pillai because we are already delayed for the day. So welcome, Ms. Ashwati Pillai, with your case presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Shobha, ma'am. Okay. Good evening to one and all present for this occasion. Today, I'm going to present the details of the patient with acute on chronic liver failure. This, his journey from chronic illness to a better outcome. So what is acute on chronic liver failure? Acute on chronic liver failure is characterized by precipitating events in patients with underlying chronic liver disease, leading to deterioration of liver and often ending in multi-organ system failure. Now, we will be going through the flow of management process from admission till discharge. Firstly, on admission, Mr. S, a 42-year-old male resident of Thane, came to Global Hospital Mumbai with complaints of fever, altered sensorium, breathlessness, decreased urine output, and jaundice. Secondly, on this basis of history, followed by a physical assessment and investigation, patient was evaluated. While taking history, we came to know that this patient was diagnosed with cirrhosis of liver 1 year back. Since March 2019 to February 2020, Mr. S had been admitted in hospital multiple times for complaints like abdominal discomfort, abdominal distension due to ascites, fever, jaundice, and altered sensorium. In October 2019, an upper GI scopy had been done due to melena, resulted in the diagnosis of esophageal candidias grade 2 and mild portal hypertensive gastropathy, which was treated with medications. In January 2020, therapeutic ascitic tapping was done. According to ascitic routine report, patient had spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, which was treated with antibiotics. Thus, recurrent jaundice and abdominal discomfort led patient for multiple admissions in hospitals. On physical assessment, patient was having altered sensorium. Hemodynamically, patient was febrile, tachycardia, hypotension was present. Saturation on room air was 90%. Skin was icteric and paler. Bilateral pedal edema was also seen. On auscultation, patient had right-sided basal lung crepes, abdomen was distended. As per renal assessment, patient had complaints of decreased urine output. As per the result of investigations done on admission and on the basis of history, patient was diagnosed as acute on chronic liver failure associated with septic shock with known complaints of decompensated liver cirrhosis, portal hypertension with ascites, jaundice, coagulopathy, and grade 1 to 2 hepatic encephalopathy. We managed this patient's conditions hemodynamically by maintaining normal blood pressure using inotropic support, using non-invasive methods for hemodynamic monitor, that is by monitoring IVC, and using invasive method, that is by PICO monitoring. Managed hepatic encephalopathy by using anti-encephalopathy measures like Dufalac enema and providing dark and quiet environment. Respiratory management was carried out by intubating and mechanically ventilating patient to protect airway in view of worsening encephalopathy. Sepsis was managed by providing broad spectrum antibiotics like meropenem, tigecycline, and polymyxin B, and antifungal like fluconazole. Renal management was carried out by ensuring adequate hydration and maintaining mean arterial pressure to achieve good renal perfusion. Now I will be providing the process of management taken place from admission. On day one, as patient was received with complaints like hypothermia, tachycardia, hypotension, and altered sensorium, we started with immediate fluid resuscitation, provided inotropic support with noradrenaline, measures to control hypothermia by providing tappet sponging. Investigations were carried out as per doctor's orders. Also provided oxygen therapy as patient saturation was only 90%. Started broad spectrum antibiotics and as mentioned previously, anti-encephalopathic measures also were carried in view of grade 1 hepatic encephalopathy. On day 2 and 3, patient's hypotension was persistent. He needed second inotrope, that is vasopressin. On day 4 till day 8, patient became hemodynamically stable. Inotropes were slowly tapered off. Patient's hepatic encephalopathy had also improved. Thus, patient shifted to ward. On day 9 and 10, patient was apparently all right. Continued antibiotics in the ward. Started high protein full diet. From day 11 to 15, unfortunately, patient's condition worsened. Patient was shifted to ICU. We had to sedate and intubate the patient. Had to put central line PICO and Foley's catheter. Pan cultures were sent. PICO monitoring was being done for optimized fluid management. Using USG abdomen screening was done for ascites, in which minimal fluid was noted but was non-tappable. Received pan culture reports, which showed minibile had growth of Pseudomonas aeruginosa with colony count of 100 CFU per ml, and blood and urine cultures was negative. So we did not escalate antibiotics, we continued the same antibiotics. From day 11 to 18, patient's hematological values deranged. HB was 6.9, platelets 18,000, INR 3.5, fibrinogen 90. So we had to administer blood products, that is PRBC, cryoprecipitate, and single donor platelets. From day 19 to 24, patient's DCS started to improve. Patient was conscious. Patient got extubated and stabilized. Coagulopathy was improving. So we began with living donor liver transplant workup. We did radiological investigations and all the cultures were also repeated. On 25th day of admission, patient was discharged and readmitted for living donor liver transplant. Surgical management has been started with preoperative process, which involves transplant workup, consents, that is anesthesia, surgical consent, high risk, blood transfusion consent, and also video consent. Arranged blood products as per our transplant protocol. Surgery was conducted, which was uneventful. And then patient was shifted to transplant ICU. Post-operative course of treatment carried out for a total 28 days. In this period, we nurses followed standard precautions and hospital infection control protocols. Due to prolonged bed rest, proper pressure relieving measures were taken. Early mobilization and physiotherapy was encouraged. Carried out proper wound and drain care. Nutritional needs were fulfilled as per requirement of patients. We nurses also play a major role in prevention of ICU complications. Special instructions. Some of the instructions were explained in previous presentations. So we'll share some other instructions. Those are shoes, to wear shoes, socks, long sleeve shirts and long pants for activities carried out which involve soil exposure, and also to avoid unnecessary sun exposure. Avoid lifting heavy weight more than 5 kg for 3 months post-transplant. Avoid crowds to minimize exposure to respiratory illness like COVID-19. Health education and discharge instructions were given regarding diet and nutrition, wound care and drain care, personal hygiene, exercise, medication, and follow-up. This was the journey of an acute on chronic liver failure to a healthy living. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Ashwati. Many of the things correlate with the previous panel presentations also. So you very well summed up the journey of Mr. S from March to June and the day-to-day management with special instructions. So a very well visual presentation also. I'm sure the audience were very well, can now correlate how we can take care of ACLF patients. Okay, so now I move forward and put forth certain questions to our panel members. My first question I put to Mr. Mihir Vora. Is Mr. Mihir Vora here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. We have seen that there are various grading for ACLF. Progress of the hospital stay helps physician ascertain whether a particular patient is likely to improve or not, and subsequently needs further treatment and liver transplantation or certain surgeries are required or not. Can we know how do you grade an ACLF? Because nurses also require to know it.
Correct, ma'am. Very eminent question. And it's very important to grade ACLF because it helps us in prognosticating people. We would want to know who patient has to be planned for transplant on an urgent basis versus where medical care can create a difference. In terms of greater insight about ICU management, these gradings depend on organ failure scores. So we use something known as Easel-Cliff score, which helps us to grade them into grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3, depending on organ failure. So when I say grade 1, I mean to say there is one organ failure. When I say grade 2, means there are two organ failures. And when I say grade 3, means there are three organ failures. Now, when we talk of organ failure, we try and say in such a way that if a person has bilirubin more than 12, we call from the liver point of view one organ failure. If there is kidneys, creat, which is more than 2, or INR more than 2.5, or person is on more than two inotropes, or PO2 by FI2 ratio less than 200, or this person is in grade 3 or grade 4 encephalopathy. So each organ based on these parameters will have been defined as part of one organ failure. So if I have two organ failures, depending on if bili is more than 12 or if somebody's INR is more than 2.5, so I will say that this person has two organ failures. So ACLF would be grade 2 as per Easel-Cliff. Or if this person has more than two inotropes or his bilirubin is more than 12, his INR is more than 2.5, then I would say this person has three organ failures. Now, this is what West tries and follows, and this is seen mostly in our ICUs where we use Easel-Cliff score. In our East, we have also taken one more criteria, which is known as R criteria, where we take into account five things. One is bilirubin, encephalopathy, INR, lactate, and creatinine, and we give them 1 to 3 points. So minimum score would be 5 and maximum would be 15. If the score is more than 11, such people would have to be planned for transplant. So we try and evaluate them medically, give them optimum care. But in 4 to 7 days of aggressive medical care, if we find scores still more than 11, such people have to be thinking of transplant. So we try and follow two scores to grade people and prognosticate them.
So then in short, if I see, then it is based on the severity and the how much is the organ damage.
Agree, ma'am. Based on organ failures. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So there are many, I think there are certain canonic studies which show this Easel-Cliff score and the SOFA score. So people can go and check those
organs. Ma'am, there is an online calculator available.
Right.
We can use those organ failures. We'll come with up a score. So it also helps us to know futility of care and then accordingly. And Akash sir will help us to go through that.
Definitely, yeah. So I'm coming next to Dr. Akash Shukla. Dr. Akash Shukla, my next is to you. The chronic liver failure score can be used to predict mortality in patient with ACLF. This score is proportional to the number of organ failure, which we have just seen. Can we know which organ failure is important in management, and how can nursing management change outcome in patients with ACLF? Because this is also very important nowadays.
Thank you, Dr. Oba. I think very pertinent questions. The first thing is which are the organ failures which are of critical importance? So I'll divide this into two parts. One, organ failures which tell me that transplant is essential. And the second is organ failures which tell me that transplant is not possible. So the first thing we have to understand is the liver failure, it is counterintuitive, is actually defined by failure of other organs. You know, when you're defining a liver failure, you don't say that bilirubin of 5 or 7 will require transplant or 20 will require transplant. You may have a patient of bilirubin of 30, but if there are other organs are all fine, there's a good chance that this person will actually improve. On the other hand, you may have a patient with bilirubin of 5 or 7, but because of his other organs being failing, because of liver, because of kidney failure and lung failure, this patient may actually have a worse outcome. So in liver failure, the outcome is usually determined by failure of other organs, especially in acute and chronic liver failure. Out of these, once the kidneys start getting involved and the brain gets involved, that is persistent hepatic encephalopathy and hepatorenal syndrome. I think these are the two key parameters, two organs, which will tell me that this patient will have a bad prognosis and requires an immediate transplant. On the other hand, if a patient with acute and chronic liver failure admitted in the ICU develops pulmonary failure, then we are actually far more worried, because this patient may not do well with even with a liver transplant because of his lung issue. So we'll have to improve his lungs, stabilize the lungs, and then only we can consider transplant. And I think this is where the nursing care is of uttermost importance. If the lung care is good, then the patient has a good chance to recover. And this is very important, because if you look at the data, the UNOS data clearly shows that people who actually have a low MELD score but a higher organ failure score actually do worse than people with a higher MELD score and low organ failure score. So even if the liver is far worse, underlying liver disease is really bad, if we take good care of the other organs, if we maintain the patients well, well ventilated, then these are the patients who are actually going to do well as compared to those patients where the other organs have started failing.
So in short, that means early diagnosis and identification of the complication is also very important by the nurses, and nurses are at the bedside. So it's very important that you should be the first identifier in this particular cases. Okay.
Yes. Thank you, Doctor. Just add one more thing here, Dr.
Yes,
Shobha?
Sir, sure. Yes,
I think the nurses have to take a lead, actually.
Right.
They should be guiding the consultants, because the consultant is going to come for 10, 15, 20 minutes, maybe twice a day, thrice a day.
That was because what I was going to say, sir, just now. Because the nurses are around the patient most of the time. The consultant comes only for 20 to 25 minutes. And ICU nurses are with the patient throughout. And this is why we are having these conferences, you know. And yeah. I think like that conferences, we should have many more, so that this can be a, we tell a tie breaker, and we can be having, we will be having this, I think, many more nowadays.
Okay. Yes, and they should feel free to tell the consultant that I disagree. I think that is where they will make a difference. They should be able to raise their voice.
Our nurses are empowered nowadays. Yes. We are seeing with this case presentations. So that is one of the way, and they are answering the questions. So that is a path breaking. Okay, so thanks a lot, Dr. Akash. Okay, now my next question is to Dr. Prashanta Rao. Sir, are you here? Dr. Prashanta Rao?
Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead.
Sir, early diagnosis and treatment of potential precipitating events are essential in the prevention of ACLF. But can you highlight when to consider the treatment and when not to consider the treatment in ACLF? Because as we tell that usually this is identified in the late stages only. The organ damage is already done. So that is why this question is for you, sir.
Let me start by apologizing on Dr. Ravi's part that he not be able to attend this meeting. In ACLF, the biggest question is always whether we should offer transplant to a patient or is it already too late?
Right.
Because it is very clear that patients who are ACLF, either they undergo transplant and may survive or they are not going to survive. There is no third way in ACLF. So when to do and when not to do is the biggest question. So multiple factors are taken into consideration. Number one, the number of organ system failures. So if it is an ACLF 1 or ACLF 2, it's a no-brainer. If the infection free, transplant is the way to go. Moment it becomes ACLF 3, that is where I would say the watershed area is. ACLF 4 is also clear that essentially speaking, it has reached the point of no return where transplant most also, you will see a bad outcome. So ACLF 3 is where we will be considering whether we to go ahead or not. Additionally, number two is the KIF score that Dr. Mee was talking about. It also, there is a organ futility score that is calculated a part of it. So they say our KIF score more than 64, or after 48 hours of ICU management, more than 70, I say it is another cutoff where we would decide that we have reached the point of no return and maybe we should not be offering transplant to the patient. And of course, other factors such as patients who have active infections in the form of either an SBP, or a pneumonia, or a positive blood culture. Because these are the underlying inciting events because of which a patient who has chronic liver disease has moved from CLD to ACLF. So the acute component is the infection which is driving the ACLF. So in a patient who has an untreated infection, or infection not completely, not under control, is another patient to whom we would not offer transplant in the setting of ACLF. Of course, if you categorize infection also, be it say pneumonia, blood culture positivity or bacteremia, SBP and UTI, which are the most common infections that we see in our patients, I would say the most dangerous infection would be a pneumonia, right? Next most dangerous, I would say, is an SBP. Next mostly or lesser, you would be a blood culture positive, and the least, or I would say, I would not say the least, but the most lesser evil of all of these four, I would say the UTI. So in that order of preference, from starting to offer transplant to reaching a point with pneumonia, I would say no transplant is how we would progress to offer patients or not offer patients transplant in ACM.
So when we talk about then liver transplantation, sir, so which is the person then we choose that we are going to give this liver transplant for the
patient? I would say number one, like I said, ACLF 1, 2 and ACLF 3 if they are otherwise fit and not infected. Number two, patients who have no infection or patients in whom the infection has been treated. So okay. These are the patients of ACLF whom we would offer transplant. So I would not exclude patients based on one organ failure and which organ failure. For example, they may be on low dose inotropes, you will still offer transplant.
Okay.
They may be on renal replacement therapy, you will still offer transplant.
Okay.
They may have encephalopathy, you will still offer transplant. They will have jaundice and coagulopathy, obviously, we will still offer transplant. So individually, they are not a problem. The moment there are three or four organ system failures in one patient, that is where we will say no. Rest all of them, if they are infection free, we would venture to offer transplant, of course, with appropriate counseling to the patients that normally if you are considering that post-transplant, an outcome of 90% success is what you are looking at. In these patients of ACLF, we are not going to be looking at a 90% outcome.
90%.
We are looking at a much lesser outcome depending on the number of organ system failures that we are starting with. But with appropriate counseling, we will still offer transplant to them. Another thing also that is might be slightly different from a standard transplant would be in these patients, the option of a cadaveric transplant essentially is not there because these patients never make it to getting registered for a cadaveric transplant and surviving with medical management till a cadaver liver becomes available. They are essentially the only realistic option for them is going to be a living donor transplant. Unfortunately, as of today in the Bombay's ATCC, the allocation of organs is not based on the severity of the disease as per the date of registration. That is why we do not get any priority for patients for extreme disease.
Very well answered, sir. Thanks a lot. Now my last question to Dynamic Supriya. Supriya, ACLF management is focused on supportive care apart from medical management, as we have already seen. Can you let us know what are the newer technologies we use in managing a sick cirrhotic patient?
Good evening, one and all. Thank you, ma'am, for the question. Global Hospital Mumbai is well known for its good clinical outcome with quality nursing care. Over here, we have the latest technologies used across the world, such as advanced hemodynamic monitoring, that is PICO monitoring, its pulse-induced counter cardiac output monitor, to monitor vital parameter like intravascular and extravascular fluid status, patient core temperature in order to maintain peripheral perfusion cardiac monitoring. We also have flow track monitoring, a minor version of PICO. We nurses are also trained to handle advanced equipment like CRRT machine with filter of toramexin, cytosoft, oxyris, and hemophil. We also have other extracorporeal therapies. And most important, nurse handle themselves this high-end equipment. Thank you, ma'am.
Finally, my last question again to you, Supriya. Just out of curiosity, it has nothing to do with this particular panel and not to do with liver actually. But since COVID, you have been continuing to do transplant. Okay. How do you to ensure that transplant patients are taken care of during this pandemic?
Yes, ma'am. We have done good number of cases during this COVID. We have done 46 cases in 2020 during this pandemic. So initial post-operative days in ICU, we do not allow any relatives to visit the patient, but nurses are taking complete responsibility to do a video call between the patient and the family member. And once the out of ICU, we have done one family member to do RT-PCR and completely stay in the patient room. And thus, we have taken care, none of our recipient have got COVID during this course of treatment. Thank you.
Excellent. I think that's the reason you have been doing so many transplant and patients are still safe, and hats off to all the global team. So I would like to thank the global team for this excellent today's presentation, what we have done. So this was the last panel. So I think it's all because of the teamwork of the complete panel members. So thanks once again to each and everyone. So I end our last panel for the day. Thank you to my panel members, all the five panel members, Dr. Akash, Dr. Ashwati, okay, Dr. Ravi Mohanty was Mohanka was not here, Meher Vora, okay, Prashanta Rao who had joined us, and Supriya. Thanks a lot. Okay, and Ms. Jessica, who is Jacinta, Jessica, and Madam Tankam. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all panel expertise for a wonderful session today. I now hand over the forum to Vinita Mascarenhas, Clinical Quality Coordinator, CDKD Global Hospital, Mumbai, to handle question answer session. Over to you, Vinita.
Thank you, Ms. Rashmi. I can only say is more than the questions, we've got compliments for today's session. Thank you to all the participants who have registered and attended. I have one question which is very special. The entire webinar was designed and conceptualized based on adult transplant. Well, sir, Dr. Anurag Shrimal, there is one question on pediatric liver transplant. The question goes as, are there any special nursing skills in handling children undergoing liver transplant?
Yes. So, nurses makes the biggest difference for the small babies. Okay, so when we do this transplant for small kids, some of them as small as 4, 5, 6 kilograms, in them, nursing care can bring in utmost difference in their outcome of the transplant. Okay, so attention to detail, to the smallest of the details, whether it is the vitals, whether it is the fluid management, because even 15-20 ml extra fluid can push them in pulmonary edema. And unless if they are dehydrated by around say 50 ml or so, they may get vascular complications, hepatic artery thrombosis. There are physiotherapy, so that's a very, very special need that for the children, that their respiratory secretion should be great, and their positioning, chest percussion has to be really gentle, but at the same time thorough, to ensure that the secretions don't get pulled off and that the child doesn't get pneumonia. The only way child express is with a cry. And like how you say that the mother understands why this child is crying. Is he hungry? Is the position not right? Is the child getting a pain? And all this assessment actually is made by the bedside nurse. And they are able to tell us most of the times that, see, this is what they feel, that now with the facial expression, the way the lips are moving, this child is hungry. And that's the reason the child is cranky, or the child may just want to sleep with the eyes being puffy and now ready to sleep. So there are these lots of indicators which the bedside nurse picks up, and they are a big asset in terms of management of these patients. And as I said, that the most important thing is attention to detail in the management of these small kids.
Thank you so much, sir, for your answer. To sum it up, I can say is that we should conduct yet another webinar on specifically pediatric liver transplant, where we can discuss more on this. So do you agree?
Absolutely, that's a wonderful suggestion.
Thank you, sir. The next question goes out to Dr. Meher Vora. Sir? So the question goes as, why is that most Indians will have liver transplant? As per all the studies that have been conducted and data, this is a very prompt question, which says that why will most of our Indians have fatty liver?
Sure. So for everything, we look up to the West, right? So there also the trend continues, like we are looking up to the West. But as what I've learned repeatedly, that we Asians are completely different from the West. Our body habitus, our body mass, our fat, our muscle, everything is different. So we do look lean, but still there can be fat in our liver. And that is the reason why we'll have much more fatty liver even as compared to the Western population. And that is why our BMI cutoffs set up have been on the lower side. So our usual advice to people is to lose body weight, fat. But here there may be so many individuals who are lean and it is very difficult for them to give that advice that they lose weight. But we still tell them that exercise and lose weight. So we are a bit different from the West in this point of view that we have a lean NASH. But yes, as across population, we have a lot of people who've got fatty liver. In terms of our OPD, 6 out of 10 people come with fatty liver. That has been our trend.
Thank you so much, sir. So the same, there's yet another question to you, Dr. Mihir Vora. What are the risks for those who have had hepatitis B in developing liver cirrhosis?
Around 80 to 90% people are asymptomatic, means they do not have any symptom or any other thing related to hepatitis B. The virus is there in the liver, but they do not have any symptom. So it doesn't mean everybody with hepatitis B needs to be started on treatment. We need meticulous follow-up and at a regular follow-up. Around 5 to 10% of such people will have inflammation in the liver, and these people have to be caught in time and we need to start treatment for the same. If not, around 20 to 30% of such individuals can develop liver failure, complications and risk of HCC. So it is very important to monitor this set of population that we start proper treatment at a proper time. But we have to remember, not everybody who has hepatitis B needs treatment, but a proper careful monitoring is very important.
Thank you so much, sir. I now hand over the mic to Ms. Jessica.
Thank you, Vinita. Thank you to the entire expert team of Global Hospital for today's enlightening panel discussion. And thank you to the nurses for the lovely presentation. We at 6 hospitals across IHH India Operation Division, we have various centers of excellence, and among which the Gleneagles Global Hospital at Chennai and the Global Hospital at Mumbai is known for its centers of excellence in adult and pediatric liver nursing excellence care. It's not only within India, we have also reached across 7 countries under the banner of IHH. And moving forward, for any questions related to this conference queries from Maharashtra chapter, you could reach out to the President, Ms. Vinci, Vice President, Ms. Shubhangi, or myself, Secretary. You could reach out to us at any point. I now hand over the session to Ms. Sharvari Jagta, a nurse educator, for a vote of thanks.
A warm and cherished evening to respected dignitaries and delegates. It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks. I extend my gratitude to National Annie founder and EC members, Madam Thangam, Dr. Jyoti Clara, Madam Shubhada, and Madam Ajita. Thanks to every respected members of Maharashtra chapter for driving it. I would like to thank our chief guest, Dr. Vivek Talawlikar, our CEO, who honored this event with his inspirational and encouraging thoughts. I would thank Dr. Jyoti Clara J. Michael for her constant support and guidance to us. A huge thank you to Dr. Samir Shah for taking this event to the next level and help us to make it a huge success. My heartfelt thanks to all the presenters and all the panelists for enlightening us with a commendable talk on the subject. I would like to extend my thanks to all the moderators, Dr. Shobha Gaikwad, Ms. Sini Siju, Ms. Sweety Mamman, for accepting to moderate the panel discussions for young nurses leaders in the best way. My sincere thanks to Ms. Rashmi for coordinating this event in such a beautiful way. Last but not the least, our CNO, Madam Jessica, for mentoring our team of young nurse, young leaders in the best possible way. My sincere gratitude to all the participants in this webinar and making it a huge success. I hope you all enjoyed it and take back the most important messages. Thank you once again.
Yeah.
Thanks to all the delegates. We end the session over here. We have put up the feedback link in the chat box. Kindly fill the feedback link.
While I end the meeting, three cheers to the global team and the Maharashtra Annie chapter. Thank you very much.